Good morning. My name is Randall Balestriero, and I will be presenting today the paper that is titled Interpretable and Learnable Super Resolution Time Frequency Representations that we did jointly with Professor Hervé Glotin from Toulon University and Professor Richard Baraniuk from Rice University. Hopefully, if you have any questions during the slides, you will be able to answer them in the paper. And if not, feel free to send me an email and I will do my best to answer any question you might have. So first, let me briefly give some context and motivation for this paper. So you might have heard in some really mediatized cases that deep learning can be used and deployed to solve some very specific tasks in a much better ways than humans can do. However, this is usually very limited to some tasks and situations, and the rate at which deep learning is deployed is not the same across different domains. And this is especially true if you consider audio applications or in general, time series applications. So the main reason for that is twofold. The first one is that most of time series applications, except maybe speech or music-related tasks, concern very specific topics and domains, such as geophysics, health, or bioacoustic. And this is really different from, let's say, computer vision, which deals with images, because images, for example, are pulled out from the web. They are extensively available, and basically, they are provided by most of internet users. As opposed to those cases, those specific time series data are first very costly to label because you need experts and usually people even with doctorates in those fields not always agree on how to label those data. So not only is it expensive, but sometimes it is ambiguous because the application is really specific. But also the data collection itself is extremely costly and limited. And this is because only people interested in those fields will have the motivation to record such data. So the combination of those two facts means that current supervised or unsupervised or self-supervised methods cannot be applied as is directly to those type of data. And if you look around at current state-of-the-art techniques, whether it is for simple, let's say, speech recognition or audio recognition and so on, you will always notice that despite the fact that there is a deep learning pipeline used at one point, first, there is always handmade processing of the raw time series. And in those three cases here, this processing is based on the short time Fourier transform, but it can vary obviously depending on the task at hand. For example, for bioacoustic data, you might encounter wavelet transforms much more often. So there is really a need to turn this component that requires expert knowledge into a learnable component to allow end-to-end learning and hopefully remove some bias that was introduced by this representation that was done by hand. So in order to learn this time frequency representation, it is common to parameterize the specific family or class of representation by adding some learnable components to it. So to illustrate this, let's consider here one framework that was published a few years ago that proposed to learn parameterized wavelet transform. So to obtain a wavelet transform, what you do is that you take a mother wavelet, as depicted here, and then you produce multiple dilations of this mother wavelet based on the geometric progression of scales. This gives you a filter band that you then apply on the raw time series through time convolutions. So what was proposed to do is to, instead of having an analytical form for the mother wavelet, have instead a parametric spline formulation, and the parameters of the splines, so the coefficients in front of each polynomials and each region, can be learned from some flavor of gradient descent. So this allowed to adapt the shape of the mother wavelet and effectively focus on different type of components that are present in the signal. Nevertheless, one key limitation is that you were constrained to live in the space of wavelet transforms. So you could go from one mother wavelet to another, but you could not reach, for example, a short time Fourier transform. So to alleviate this limitation that was present in this example I displayed, but also in all currently existing learnable time frequency representations, we propose instead a slight reformulation of the problem that will enable us to not only learn a specific representation within a family of time frequency representation like wavelets, but also to move between different families. So to do this, what we do is first to take the raw time series X and move it to a new domain through the Wigner-Weil transform. So this is completely deterministic. It does not remove any information about the signal. The signal can be reconstructed exactly from this representation. And this will give us a much better adapted image representation, time frequency representation, which can then span any desired wavelet transform or short time Fourier transform and so on. And the way you can reach any of them is by doing a time convolution of this Wigner-Weil transform with a Gaussian, two-dimensional Gaussian filter. So you do the convolution through time, and you have possibly different Gaussian kernels for each frequency of the output time frequency representation that we denote here K. And basically, through this, the only learnable parameters are the center frequency of the Gaussian filter and the covariance matrix. So basically, through this, it will be possible to shift in frequency the filter, so where does it look for information, and also change, for example, the sharpness or the precision in time and frequency of the filter. And this means that one can now reach any desired time frequency family only by learning four parameters for each filter of the filter bank. And in general, in most of the tasks, filter bank is composed of between 80 to 120 filters. So it does not introduce a lot of degrees of freedom, and still it can represent most of the currently used time frequency representations, interpolate in between and go beyond them by reaching super resolution, meaning that you can have a much more precise time and frequency resolution than commonly used representations. So here is a brief example on how the parameterization of the Gaussian filter can lead to known representation. On the left, you have a specific case where the variance for the time axis is relatively small, and the variance for the frequency axis is proportionally larger. And through this parameterization, what you actually recover is a short time Fourier transform with a small time window. Now, going the other way, if you parameterize your Gaussian filters to have a large time variance and a small frequency variance, what you obtain is a short time Fourier transform with a large window. So what you can see from this is that directly by studying the covariance matrix, you obtain the time and frequency resolution of your representation, and you can link it to known existing representations. So you can actually interpret what has been learned. So here, those are two examples, but since the parameterization of each filter is independent from the other, you can see that you could combine both of them and, for example, reach wavelet transform or reach choplet transform if you have a non-diagonal covariance matrix. So all of those transforms can be represented and reached only by learning those parameters for each filter. So to validate the usefulness of this representation, we did some classification tasks on various datasets, some consisting of actual speech, which is the NIST and Google command dataset, other consisting of bioacoustic data, such as birds and different type of whales for the Dog10 dataset. And we did this for multiple models. And the key is to consider models with increasingly high degrees of modeling. And those models are basically taking as input the learned representation K that I introduced before. And what you can see is that due to the high degree of adaptivity of the proposed representation, when the model that follows it is extremely simple, such as a linear scattering, the gain in performance is very important. And of course, as you use a more and more complicated model on top of the learned representation, as this gap reduces. So this is very important, for example, for energy constrained models and so on, where having a very well adapted representation straight as the input of the classifier allows to have a much better performance while keeping the classifier very simple. So if you look at the learned filters, here it was for the bird task, you can also very easily interpret what they try to encode. And for example, here you can see that as the center frequency that goes from zero at the bottom to the Nyquist at the top, as the center frequency of the filters increase, as the time and frequency resolution increases, and also the sharpness starts appearing when you reach the high frequency filters. Another important aspect of our representation is that it can reach super resolution. And what this means is that you can have filters like this one, for example, which are extremely localized both in time and frequency, and are thus very accurate at encoding very small duration events or very localized frequency events. And this is not the case if you use conventional transforms, which are basically limited in their precision in time and frequency. And so with this, again, by letting the parameters be learned, you can really reach super resolution if needed or not, as for those filters which are encoding more frequency near Nyquist over two. So this is, of course, just the beginning. And what we hope is to generalize this model for unsupervised learning. So all the tasks that we did was supervised classification. So the filters were learned in order to minimize the classification loss. But we can very easily use some concepts from optimal time frequencies by doing some entropy minimization to find the Gaussian parameterization that will lead to a representation with minimal entropy. So this would be one way to generalize this work for unsupervised training. And of course, we can then study all the modalities between unsupervised and supervised as done in semi-supervised training. So hopefully there will be a way to deploy this proposed learnable time frequency representation on more complicated tasks and possibly some real world tasks. And we are hoping to see that happening soon. Thanks. Bon.